Welcome to Nuked Radio. Today's episode number 30. It is May the 10th, 2012. With me today is Jules and Kurt from Room 101 on Orion Talk Radio. How are you guys doing today?
Good afternoon, Christina.
Great, Christina. How are you?
And you guys are hanging out together, huh?
Yeah.
Yes, we are.
Nice.
Visiting the man cave.
The last week or so, we've been pretty busy. I went on a Boston radio show last week, and I was on Popeye's show, Federal Jack, down the rabbit hole on Friday with a DA from Texas talking about some of the police stuff I've been going through. And The Lie, Jules and I hosted that on Sunday, and then we were on WTF, too. And if you guys ever get a chance, please check it out if you want to laugh at some of the news going on. It's a great show, and Kurt is there a lot, too. And then I was on Joe and Tim's show Tuesday, and I'm hoping to get an interview with Dr. Bill Deagle and Indiana Preppers in the next week or so. I can't believe it's been 30 shows already.
Doesn't feel like it.
Happy 30th.
Thanks. Jules, what was your favorite show or most memorable?
Most memorable was getting to meet Kevin Blanch virtually. That was awesome.
Yeah. Yeah, and Miss Milky's made a bunch of appearances on here, too, and we love having her around.
Yes, I love Miss Milky. We haven't seen her in a while, so if you're out there, feel free to come visit one day.
Okay, I'm going to see her sometime this week. We're going to have coffee. If you missed Tuesday's show, we had on Nibiru Magic from YouTube, and he put out a little thank you video for us, Nuked Radio and I. And since he posted that, I've had 48 new subs on YouTube.
Awesome.
And if you're not on YouTube, what that means is that people will see your video and then subscribe to your feed, so it'll show up in their feed. And he emailed me last night and said that he's been invited now to go on an Irish talk radio show. And he said, what have I started? So good luck to him. He was a great interview, and I love how he just picked up and started reading the news for us, because I was having some tech problems that morning. So it was great having him on. Earthquake update. Overnight, there was another 5.2 in Japan. It was quite a bit north of Sendai. And then there were a few 4.0s. We had a 2.5 in Arkansas and a 3.5 in Wyoming. All in all, the quakes have been pretty quiet for a few days. In fact, we haven't had a 7.0 since mid-April. And we haven't had a 6.0 since, I believe, May the 1st. So sometimes that indicates that we're going to be having a cycle of earthquakes. We'll drop the links for those monitoring sites for you guys in chat. Something else I wanted to bring to everyone's attention, there's been some high radiation readings posted yesterday and this morning. Please check out the forecast if you haven't done so, and feel free to share it anywhere on social media. A person in Chapel Hill, North Carolina, got 28 times background. This is from a guy on Radiation Watch who knows what he's doing. Philly had some high numbers yesterday, too, and the day before. I had some high numbers here as the storm front went through. I was driving in my car yesterday, and I was hitting some pretty big spikes when it started raining. Jules, you said there were 30s and 40s showing up in Indiana this morning.
Yeah, right along the border between Illinois and Indiana. And then I saw that there were a couple 50s around Connecticut and New York City, and 62 near Colorado. Those were quite high.
You can go to Radiation Network online and take a look, but the page refreshes every minute, so it's hard to see what has gone on there previous. I prefer to look at graphs. I wanted to share some comments that I've been getting, some emails and some posts that I saw on a couple other sites. This was posted under the forecast yesterday. Expecting rain in the Houston, Texas area Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. I will be inside all 3 days. I used to love just standing in the warm spring rain and letting it soak me through. Now I have noticed that I get small patches of red skin if I get in the rain for more than a minute or so. Things are hot down here, and I'm not talking about the weather. Another comment on the video that I did about how radiation gets into our food and makes us sick. My whole family has been feeling very weak for a while now. We're starting to get hair loss and weird bruising all over our bodies. We live in South Texas, So some of this could be from core exit raining down on us too. I hope it doesn't get any worse. And I sent her some links to Fukushima facts and mitigation. Another comment on the radio show from Tuesday. Thank you. You all are so wonderful. I wish you'd do a show every single day. Jules, how do you feel about that?
I wish we could do a show every single day.
I do too.
It was a lot, though, and it was a lot of mental fortitude that was required to deal with this stuff 5 days a week.
Silly of me, because it's not like there's much I can do to safeguard my son and I living in a one-floor apartment building in Wisconsin, but somehow it's comforting to know all that can be known, which is what you're giving to us. I do try to stay informed in every way I can now. I monitor the USGS, determine how close the quakes are to the plant, and stay close to Fukushima Diary. Just wish I could afford a Geiger counter. And I wrote them back and said, you really don't need one. Just treat everything like it's radioactive and act appropriately and make your health a priority. Because, I mean, even those of us who have Geiger counters, and if you're doing it for research, then you want to do a lot of measuring. But, I mean, in practical everyday life, it'll drive you crazy to have that thing on all the time beeping at you. Another comment, and this was on Alexander Higgins' blog. I used a digital meter to check Western Washington trees and found unbelievably high radiation levels in plants and trees on my property. Cesium-137 is suspected. And some obvious issues with the plants. Some are burnt, dating back to last year when the radiation made landfall 8 days later here in Western Washington state. I sustained radiation burns on my arm when it rained. The yellowish metallic smell dripping off onto my car and my arm and soaked through the material onto me. I did not immediately decontaminate because I was in denial.
Oh, my goodness.
Now the background radiation on plants and trees is quite high. The government is lying to you all. And this was posted on a thread on GLP yesterday. West Coast radiation problems. For the past several months, my normally healthy family has been having random health problems. Not sure about the other people around me. I haven't asked them. My mom and I have both the same problem with painful sores inside our noses. If we rub or blow our nose, it will bring tears to our eyes. I've been having reoccurring ear infections, swimmer's ear type infections, where the ear canals will swell shut and hurt like hell. My oldest son has had recurring strep throat with blisters, but they aren't white. Plus, he is constantly complaining of his stomach hurting. My younger son has had constant stomach pain, pneumonia, bronchial infections, headaches, muscle aches, and just had surgery for a hernia. I doubt the hernia has anything to do with possible radiation poisoning unless it was caused from the constant coughing he has been doing. Plus, he lives at the coast. My daughter has developed these brown, rough, dry patches on her arms, right below the elbows, and on both feet, right below the ankles. All of these things have started within the past 5 or 6 months, and normally we are all very healthy. I'm also not normally the type to think the worst, but this is very concerning to me, and living in Oregon, less than 40 miles from the beach, I'm concerned about the possibility of radiation with all these sudden health problems with my family and myself. I am wondering if anyone else who lives along the West Coast is having similar sudden health issues. And judging from the responses to this, a lot of people are. You know, I feel so bad for people who have no clue. I mean, they must think they're going crazy, experiencing, you know, so many symptoms. If they don't know anything about Fukushima, which a lot of people still don't. And we are back. Jules just informed me there was a 3.7 in eastern Texas. And I also wanted to make a comment about that last couple items that I read. The yellow stuff the guy was referring to that was on his car, it looks like pollen. That's something that was widely documented outside of Chernobyl around Japan after the reactors exploded. And it's actually iodine, strontium, and plutonium will all look like yellow pollen, and uranium too. That's why they call it, sometimes refer to it as yellow cake. And in the past few months, we've also correlated yellow skies to high Geiger readings. So just something to keep in mind. An article posted on Gawker yesterday, Geiger counter wielding Fukushima hipsters make monitoring nuclear fallout cool. The folks at Radiation Watch come to mind. It's been more than a year since the Japanese tsunami caused a meltdown at Fukushima, but a bit of background radiation has not stopped a crew of Japanese hipsters from doing their hip business in the area. They've formed the Gamma Watch Squadron, the world's coolest nuclear watchdogs. For months, the Gamma Watch Squad has been taking Geiger counter readings around Fukushima and posting the results to Instagram, complete with faux vintage filters. The leader of the crew appears to be a Japanese rapper named Deli, a member of the hip-hop group Nitro Microphone Underground. I first found the Gamma Watch Squad's work on the blog Fukushima Diary, which aims to expose what its proprietor says is a media blackout of still dangerous conditions around Fukushima. In between snowboard sessions and rapping and YouTube videos, Deli and his friends take readings and pose in hazmat suits while documenting elevated radiation levels around kids playing barefoot in a stream. So I'll drop you guys this link so you can check it out. What's not cool is something that showed up in the Alaska Dispatch today. Floats, gunk, and other tsunami debris is hitting the Gulf of Alaska beaches big time. Debris from the Japanese tsunami has begun to wash ashore along Alaska's outer beaches to a dramatic extent, delivering floats, barrels, gunk, plus one errant soccer ball recovered on Middleton Island, according to Facebook posts, news reports, and eyewitness accounts from around the region. And unless you search out these local news stories, they're not really talking about this on mainstream, unless they're putting together some feel-good story about getting the Harley back to its owner. The tragic flotsam from one of the world's worst disasters of the new century has been arriving months earlier than originally predicted, actually a year earlier. By models based on the behavior of ocean currents, with the wind scooting the stuff thousands of miles across the surface of the sea at surprising speed, it's safe to say that it's here. Director Merrick Burden told Kodiak Fisheries journalist Lane Welch last week in an interview that appeared in her Fish Factor column. What we're finding are wind-driven objects like buoys, styrofoam, large containers, some of which contain materials that are potentially toxic. We're finding drums full of things and we don't know what they are yet. So we're looking at a potential large-scale environmental problem, and what we're dealing with now is just the start of it. I have not seen anyone run a Geiger over any of this stuff yet. And hopefully some of the people on YouTube will get on that. What is also not cool is the desperation that is starting to show up in Japan from having to deal with this issue. And this is posted on Any News today. Fukushima woman poured gasoline over her body and set self on fire. Family blames TEPCO, along with three other family members. Mikio Wantabe plans to bring the case to the Fukushima District Court on May 18th. He and his family argue that the Fukushima nuclear disaster led his wife, Hamako, to suffer depression and commit suicide at the age of 58. Another story posted on Any News today, SOS from local official, I can't take it anymore. Black dust over 5.5 million becquerels per kilogram. They're going to do what? Have spring athletic meets? A swimming pool opening? I mean, the denial of the government is just outrageous. What these people are having to go through. 5.5 million becquerels per kilogram? I know it was like 2,800 CPS or counts per second. And now there's red dust that's been showing up too. That's highly radioactive. This was originally posted on XSKF. And there's an assemblyman named Oyama who is very upset about this. Asia Pacific Journal, surging suicide rate among Fukushima evacuees. The figures have been fabricated to save face. Officials press hard for cover-ups. And that comes from an NGO leader. In this beautiful season of spring, under a bed of sakura petals, there is a hidden facet of life here that the Japan media and the state do little to publicize, the surging suicide rate among evacuees. Do you remember, Jules, how many people are still displaced and living in shelters?
I don't, but there's a large number. I mean, I don't think very many people have been able to go home, or they even have homes to go home to.
Nobody in the bureaucracy wants to take responsibility for the deaths of these people in order to conceal their fault. Police and city officials press hard for cover-ups, such as classifying the suicides as accidents or death from sickness. And the suicide cases are expected to grow. Dr. Fumitaka, a psychiatrist at the Yui Clinic in Tokyo, explains why. In the first year after the disaster, people do not have enough room to consider their own psychological health as they are striving so hard to restore their material lives to where they were before the disaster. What they lost returns to them with the strongest impact around the first year anniversary. There's been some other suicides too. One of them that was publicized was a city council member in Tokyo who started going around and measuring playgrounds and said that he was going to start doing this on a regular basis to provide info. And then the next day they found him dead. So our hearts go out to the people of Japan. As bad as the situation is here, it's nothing compared to what they're going through. Remember, there's always someone who has it worse than you do. Shocking report, rumors of stressed out Fukushima nuclear workers attacking women. And we've talked about before how in animals around Chernobyl, they saw very aggressive tendencies. And there's been some reports that this is showing up in some of the TEPCO workers as well. And that's posted on any news today. Of course, our biggest concern are the kids. And something that has been sent to me a few times from the people in chat, we are all the children of Fukushima. There's a website called Lollipops of Life, Hope for the Children of Japan. A woman started this project. She's trying to make it a global effort where you can donate money for these heart-shaped lollipops. They contain some of the minerals that Dr. Chris Busby has recommended, calcium and magnesium, to block cesium and strontium uptake in children. Check it out. I'll put a link in chat. We'll be back shortly. You're listening to Nuked Radio.
Are people looking for something new? I'm gonna make a summer changes too. The guy I loved has gone away. I'm gonna make a change today. Ooh, there'll be a change in the weather.
Welcome back to Nuked Radio. In other nuclear news, former president of France, Sarkozy, lied about visiting Fukushima, and he admitted to it. As you may know, in France, they had an election last week, and he lost, thank goodness. It's coming out of London. French President Nicolas Sarkozy on Friday admitted that he did not visit Fukushima during a trip to Japan after the tsunami last March, but he had told an election rally that he had. Election rival Francois Hollande questioned Sarkozy's claim that he had been to the nuclear plant, BBC reported. Sarkozy admitted that he had not. And then he gets defensive about it. He says, I'm not an engineer. I don't need to stick my nose in the situation at Fukushima. He was quoted by French TV channel iTélé. The president had told an election rally in Normandy recently that he had visited the Fukushima plant with his then ecology minister, Nathalie Morissette. I mean, these lying politicians are really something. And it's not just here, and it's not just in Japan. This is France. What he said was, I went to Japan with his ecology minister. I met the Japanese authorities. I discussed with the then prime minister the situation at Fukushima, and his ecology minister went there. He never went there. It's the first time in the history of the Republic that an outgoing candidate has described a trip he never made. And this was not the first lie that he's told. In 2009, he posted on Facebook a picture of himself at the Berlin Wall, saying he had chipped away at it with a pickaxe on the day it came down. A caption dated the photo November 9th, 1989, but the man who took it later said it was from the following day. in case you see a trend here, can't trust the government. And I had another story. This was on Disclosed TV. It's being widely reported in alternative media. I have not seen a mainstream source pick this up yet, but it is worth mentioning. This was posted on May the 3rd. A single nuclear weapon has gone missing as of last week. One of four missing, but this one is more missing than the other. The Thames Valley Police, well known for their fictional representations in the Colin Dexter detective novels, detained a substantial ranking government security officer department to that will continue to be unnamed at the behest of what we are told is the property secretary. The time we place a contact into Inspector Lewis. To put this in American English, a nuclear weapon that wasn't supposed to exist, a single 500 kiloton hydrogen bomb, one of four that are being tracked, was seen being loaded at the German port of Bremerhaven, Germany. The groups assisting in what we were informed was a counter-terrorism surveillance operation. It's been the American NSA, British M16, the Office of Naval Intelligence, and the British Royal Navy. The device was loaded onto a German-built Dolphin submarine and left the harbor doing 7.5 knots. The submarine disappeared, even though currently being tracked by each and every sophisticated device NATO would seem to be capable to borrow. At least one of the people from among the listed companies was arrested by the local police force in Oxford, their electronic surveillance gear seized. Attempts to track the sub in the busy harbor were in vain, and it is unknown what the nationality of the crew had been or the destination. Well, they certainly weren't tracking them very well. So in light of the upcoming meeting in Chicago, I wanted to mention that story. There's another story coming out of Iran. This was posted in the Telegraph, UK paper. New satellite photographs appear to show that unusual activity has taken place in recent weeks at the Parchin site outside Tehran, according to the Institute for Science and International Security. A large stream of water pictured flowing from the building, said to feature an explosive chamber for testing, raises concerns that Iran may have been washing inside the building. A series of unidentified items were also shown lined up outside the building in the April 9th photographs. Pictures taken in March and July of 2011 showed neither, suggesting unusual recent developments. Iran should immediately allow IAEA inspectors into the Parchin site to allow access to this specific building, said Mr. Albright, a former inspector. It should also explain the purpose of these activities. And I'll drop this into chat for you guys so you can see the aerial shot from the satellites. Not sure what's going on there. And there was also a story that I believe there was an IAEA inspector that was killed in a car accident a few days ago. And a little more has been posted about Chicago. Very concerning if you're a Chicago resident. This was posted on Alexander Higgins' blog yesterday. Feds declare martial law red zone around Chicago Loop for NATO meeting. And this has been verified. This is what Alexander wrote. If transportation security pat-downs at public venues, thousands of drones over the skies of America, and the National Security Agency's new echelon-like listening center in Utah weren't enough to convince you that we're living in a police state, then perhaps the latest news out of Chicago will change your mind. As world leaders prepare to meet in the Windy City for their annual NATO summit, U.S. federal officials are working feverishly to implement a security net so broad that it encompasses the entirety of Cook County, Illinois. While international summits are traditionally met with a larger police presence and preparations for the possibility of protests or rioting, what's taking place on American soil in anticipation of the May 20th meeting in downtown Chicago can be interpreted in only one way, the implementation of regional martial law. Last week, Red Cross officials reported that the City of Chicago, Department of Homeland Security, and the Secret Service had instructed them to prepare for a mass evacuation of the city in the event of an emergency during the NATO summit. The Red Cross was to prepare to shelter and feed residents in the event of such an evacuation. On the heels of that announcement, more details have emerged, and they suggest the federal security apparatus has completely lost its marbles. Kurt, have you been hearing anything else about this upcoming meeting?
No, I haven't. I've heard pretty much what you had just discussed, and it's very scary. A red zone, red zone, red alert. Unbelievable. Was it Chicago that Putin is not showing up to? Was it that? No, that's the G8. Okay. No, it's unbelievable. Wanting to evacuate citizens. They've been setting up for it for a while, you know, and we've been called, you know, crazy for even mentioning that something like this could happen. And this is just, you know, over a meeting, you know, a meeting of people in positions to really change the course, if you will, of the future. And they have the money, you know, where there lies massive amounts of just endless supplies of money. Well, comes a lot of power, and all of a sudden the money just isn't worth going after, and it's more about power. And when these men of power get together, they have to do something like this. They have to, you know, go to the extent of checkpoints and possible evacuation of citizens. Just up and leave your home. It is absolute crazy. It really has to make one wonder, when extremes like this are taken, what exactly is being talked about.
Mm-hmm. You know, too, Christina, it's interesting that we talked the other day about them doing the trainings on how to handle a dirty bomb at the hospitals. And then if you remember, a month back, we were having all those issues at the nuke plant outside of Chicago there, too. I don't know. I haven't heard much else about that. I'm gonna make a
summer changes too. No, it says in this article, what we do know is the Red Cross and local government are preparing for mass evacuations of thousands of residents in case of a national security event. If we hear anything else on this, we'll be posting it on Ratchik and Fukushima Facts. Stay tuned. You're listening to Nuked Radio. Welcome back to Nuked Radio. We are in the last segment of episode 30. Speaking of militarization in U.S. cities, Madison Rupert, who runs the End the Lie website and is a host on Orion as well, published an article a day or two ago, and Jules is going to read something from that.
I found this article pretty interesting. I'm just looking at some of the other things that have been going on nationwide here over the last, you know, even few months. I mean, this morning with JJ, he was going through all the things that have happened since January 1st, and it's really mind-numbing if you look at it. But this article was titled, U.S. Military Conducts Realistic Urban Training Exercise in Miami. Miami residents were startled to hear the sounds of low-flying military helicopters and explosions emanating from the abandoned Grand Bay Hotel in the early hours of Tuesday morning. Turns out that the United States military was conducting a, quote, realistic urban training exercise involving 100 soldiers organized by the U.S. Special Operations Command, or SOCOM. Jan Weir, a Miami resident who was awoken at around 1:45 a.m. by the din of military helicopter blades slicing through the air, said it was quite a shocking experience, referring to the helicopters which later dropped soldiers onto the roof of the Grand Bay Hotel. According to the Miami Herald, it was kind of a bizarre feeling that you would be, that you were surrounded by wind, she added. Must be what? Because of all the helicopters.
And what city was this?
This was in Miami.
You know, they did something similar in Chicago a few weeks ago before anything came out about the preparations for the NATO summit. They had a invasion of Black Hawk helicopters. You know, since when do they run these drills and not warn people?
Yeah, they did it once in LA too, I remember, with all the helicopters coming down. Yeah, it's pretty nuts. And, you know, you want to talk about trying to scare people. I mean, it would make me believe that they're doing it on purpose then, because otherwise wouldn't you be alerting people, you know? But what was interesting about this is that they were using what so-called simulated explosions and gunfire. They had over 100 military personnel, 3 military helicopters, and used simulated explosions and gunfire.
Wow. You know, like Nipper Magic was saying the other day, we need to become, you know, citizen journalists. Make YouTube videos. If you're around, if you see any of these, like, troop movements or military drills that are being done, and upload them to YouTube. We want to switch gears here, too, and talk about the sun, because we got some big stuff going on. And there's a girl who has a solar alert blog. In fact, it's called My Solar Alerts. Citizen journalist, citizen scientist. She has a great site, and it's always updated. There was an M5.7 flare and CME from sunspot 1476 and a string of big C flares just in the last 20 hours or so. And this thing is a monster, and it's turning to face us. It's facing us right now, actually, and will be for a couple of days.
I believe it was 100,000 kilometers wide, and they said it's the largest one that we've seen in recent memory.
It's huge, and it's very, very active, and it's kicking out some big flares in rapid succession. And the problem with that is when these hit our magnetosphere, which we can't look at anymore because they took the site down a couple of days ago. You know, that's supposed to protect the Earth from some of this stuff. And when it gets hit, boom, 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 in a row like that, it can't keep out all the solar radiation that it usually does.
And we seem to see quite an uptick in larger earthquakes.
We do. And then if you guys heard Matt Stein when he was on here, one of these big flares gets through, it could fry our electrical grid. Now, it could also just knock out satellites and GPS, and you might have problems with your internet and cell phones and things like that. You know, it's difficult to predict exactly how this will affect us. I'll share this link with you guys, and let me just read here what she posted. Most recent update, sunspot 1476 has not lost any steam as it turns into a direct Earth-facing position. On May 11th at 4:18 UTC, 1476 produced an M5.7 that was closely followed by a C7.9 and a C8.3. It would appear that there was a CME produced in association with the 5.7. CME had an eastward direction of ejection. Because of this, more data is needed to know if this will be geo-effective or not. Major flares are possible from 1476, and I think yesterday they were saying 20% chance of X flares. And those are the real strong ones that we worry about with our grid. So keep an eye on that. I enclosed something about that with the forecast also, although I labeled the sunspot wrong. I think I said it was 1479. It's actually 1476. And there's a nice video on there too about the ISS flying over Earth with the northern lights in action. And that's something very cool that might come out of all this. We may see some northern lights tonight, especially since so much of the U.S. is clear weather-wise right now.
Christina, I just took a look, and actually for today we have a 10% chance for X, 65% chance for M. So
all right.
That's good.
And there's the link for you guys. And now to end the show today, I wanted to read an article to you. And this is not verified. This is one person's opinion. Her name is Tacoma Groove, and I've been following her posts on any news for quite a while. She has made some excellent observations from the beginning of this disaster, and most of what she has said has been true. Everything that I followed up on has been, and she has got a little bit of insight into what is going on right now at Fukushima that I want to share with everybody. And again, this is just an opinion, but I thought it was a really good one. Reactor 1 is a full-on China syndrome. The fuel had lost all containment in June of 2011. Melting its way through the bottom of the reactor, it currently sits unmoderated by boron, producing googles of radionuclide decay products every hour. This is the real problem. It is leaking directly into the Pacific Ocean via groundwater channeling. The amount of fuel located within the unit is capable of contaminating all aquatic life within the entire Pacific Ocean, species for species. We are all now in talking head mode, but your heads are only repeating the ifs and whens of mainstream media. You should and could easily see that the Reactor 1 has been the primary concern of the Japanese and TEPCO since March 2011. Hence the tent that was erected in 2011, which merely hides the Reactor Unit 1. I think Ms. Milky refers to it as a circus tent. If Unit 4 were the primary concern, TEPCO would have built a concrete housing around the reactor to support the unit. Week 1. However, the tent does have a secondary purpose, which is trapping open air fission products, which undoubtedly hamper the use of robotic cranes, which cannot operate within the vicinity of high gamma radiation environments. So you are right to address Reactor 4 as a concern to humanity, but your focus is offbeat. Reactor 1 is a runaway train. Its containment is so far lost, no human has entered nor can enter the facility for a time period 2.5 minutes without succumbing to acute radiation poisoning. That being said, what can you do? Think about that. In full radioactive protection, you will die within only a few short minutes. Meanwhile, you see that TEPCO plans to build a 100-foot wall or barrier to contain the oceanic radiation releases on site. Why is this more important than a concrete steel frame for Reactor 4? Put two and two together. If Reactor 4 was the primary threat, why would TEPCO be building an oceanic barrier instead of a cement housing surrounding the Reactor 4 spent fuel pool? It's not a matter of budget. It is a matter of need. The oceanic contamination is obviously out of hand. Senator Wyden was not allowed near Reactor 1. Hence, he has no comments or knowledge of this situation, although I thank him for attempting to wake the masses. I feel it's time you all woke up to the China syndrome occurring all year. So she brings up some very good points in that post, her theory about what's really going on there. They have been paying a lot of attention to Reactor 1, and we don't hear a lot of news about temperatures and things like that. I do recall on the cameras at night before they put the Nalgene haze over it to mask some of the open air fission reactions or neutron beam events that we were seeing different colors. In fact, I have a playlist on my channel on YouTube called TEPCO Camera Faves, and I'll post a link for you guys in chat where you can see these open air fission events. After they put that Nalgene cover over the camera, you can't really see them anymore. But at times at night, there were bright, bright flashes happening inside of Reactor 1. And of course, it's all closed up and covered. Obama may have said there was nothing to worry about, but he also said in his speech to stay informed. So that's what we're trying to do here, and encourage other people to share love and caring and concern for your fellow man and tell them about Fukushima. We will be back next Tuesday. You've been listening to Nuked Radio. Thanks, Jules, and thank you, Kurt.